This program proudly brought to you by the Also Foundation, developing the lesbian and gay community for over 15 years.
I'm Duncan, and Ben TV caught up with Peter Zente at the Gary McEwan Gallery this week. How you doing today, Peter?
Oh, really well. Yeah, great.
So let us know a little bit about yourself.
Well, I've started art about 10 months ago.
So you're a sculptor, yeah?
Yeah. I have many mediums, I think, that I'll be going through. At the moment, I'm sculpting.
And how many sculptures do you have at the Gary McEwan Gallery at the moment?
Three at the moment. All different ones. One's called Hunger of Souls, the other one is Zétoile, and the other one's called La Serine.
Okay, and I believe one of those has been causing a little bit of controversy in St Kilda.
Yeah, just a bit. That's the Zétoile.
Okay, and what visually about it do you think has been causing that controversy?
Probably the body parts, the babies in bottles blowing bubbles.
Okay, so there's chopped up babies at the base of the sculpture?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, yeah. And why? What is it about that sculpture? Where are you at in that sculpture?
Right, well, the babies at the base are basically about how that we're touched by every person we meet. And the gun that's in the base of it is about the weapon that we use to fight the evils that we use in our lives.
And what sort of evils have you had to fight during your time?
I've contracted HIV about 5 years ago, and about 3 years ago I ended up in hospital and nearly died. And yeah, so I've turned to art.
Okay, and how's your health at the moment?
Brilliant, yeah, really good.
So you're fully recovered from your last bout and kicking on and going to be okay?
Yeah, I am. Well, I'm using my art to heal myself, so a lot of it may be disturbing to some people, but to others they may understand where I'm coming from.
Do you think that there could be some sort of similarity between the controversy and the shocking nature of HIV and your pieces?
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, because the things that I make are from my soul. I'm bearing parts of myself. And their feelings that I have and I need to express.
Okay, and have you always been creative, or has this just been a later development?
It's been a later development. I started around about 10 months ago and just sort of progressed, and Hunger of Souls was the first piece I produced.
So all this talk of a baby sculpture, let's actually have a look at what Peter's created.
Okay, well, I'll describe the piece a bit more in detail now. As I said before, the body parts at the bottom are a representation of the people that touch our lives And the gun represents the weapon that we use to fight people that we don't particularly like. And the little growly snap snap is basically there to represent the devils that we fight constantly through our lives.
And probably the most disturbing image, Peter, is the baby in the bottle. What does that mean to you?
Well, the baby in the bottle is female, and that represents life. All females produce life, as we know, and the electrodes represent the technology that we're born into. It blows bubbles because that is the breath that we breathe. The water is the life. And I've surrounded it in green moss to represent the lungs, the trees, the plants that give us this breath.
Okay, and what about the voodoo sort of spiritual head that's on top?
Well,
seems to be pretty striking.
Right, well that's basically about how I've done an abstract form of myself as a tribal sort of totem look. The feathers sort of represent the many nations that we are on this planet. And it's basically sort of like a way out there thing about myself. The third eye is about seeing the world, seeing what it has to offer.
Another one of your sculptures, Peter Le Sirene, is definitely more appealing to a conservative public. Tell us a little bit about that one.
Well, Le Sirene is the mermaid, and everybody loves mermaids. And this mermaid shopping for shells. The mermaid actually, for me, represents birth, water into air. The whale represents creation. And the water in this piece, yet again, represents life.
Peter, not only do lamps, you do freestanding sculptures as well.
Yes. Well, this is actually my first piece that I ever made. Produced about 10 months ago. Well, it's basically self-explanatory. It's about starvation. But the thing that I discovered with this piece was that I actually learnt something from it. And that was that I realised after I'd completed it that this is how I actually felt at the time when I moved.
We've seen most of your work, Peter, but let us know who's influenced you through your short career.
Right, well the country is Spain, so it's Dali, Picasso, Gaudi, and also a friend of mine called Ondra. She told me how to, well, basically explain to me that art needs to feel, you need to feel art and show people how to feel through art.
Okay, well, I definitely think you're making a fair few people in St Kilda feel a bit, and we wish you all the best and hope it goes really well and hope your health keeps up.
Great, thank you.
Peter's work can be seen at the Gary McEwen Gallery, which is in 137 Ackland Street. We'd like to thank them for their help and support, and they're open 7 days a week, 10 till 7.
Hi, and welcome to this week's edition of Open Page. I'm Rowan, and this is Lindsay, and we're coming to you live from the Nicholas Building in Swanston Street in Melbourne. This week, the first book we're looking at is Glove Puppet by Neil Drennan. It's a very dark and sinister side of a little boy growing up in London and then who comes to Sydney. It's a great read with some fabulous lines written throughout the book. Now, Lindsay, what are you looking at first this week?
Well, first of all, this week, Rowan, I'm going against tradition. I'm actually going to review the cover of the latest Jackie Collins thrill novel. Now, this is just outrageous. I've started to read. I've never read Jackie Collins before in my life. But, Rowan, if you just feel this for me.
Oh, I love
it. It's gorgeous.
See,
now, this... Excuse me, please, Rowan. And I'm moving in with you, please. Oh. And this is actually number 344 out of 800. We're lucky enough to have this special copy. We may have a competition for this book further down the track.
I believe Jackie actually wrote to you.
She did. Jackie actually wrote to me. Do you want me to read it out?
Yeah, why not?
Do we have time?
Got time.
Hi, Lindsay. Thrill is my 17th book, and I am delighted to report that not one of my books has ever been out of print. Telling stories has always been my thrill, and I will continue to tell them as long as you keep reading. Well, she's writing that to me too, Rob. Thrill is a psychological, sexual, erotic thriller. I hope you have as much fun reading it as I had writing it. Happy reading, Jackie Collins. So she wrote to me, so I'm very pleased with that, and we may actually give that away further down the track.
You must feel so special with that book this
week. Well, I do, and especially this book.
Gorgeous.
And it's real food.
Second book I'm looking at this week is by Graham Hankin, the author of 50 Ways to Say Fabulous, which came out a couple of years ago. This one's Vanity Fierce. It's a another look, sort of in boy growing up in Sydney. So, yeah, another great read. I'm sort of halfway through it at the moment, and it seems to be quite fabulous. Another good Australian book. Now, what are you looking at, though?
See, well, I'm going against tradition yet again, Rowan, and I'm going to review Pan's Guide to Discount Melbourne. Now, this is not the type of book you can actually sit down and read, of course, because it breaks up with, you know, Oakley. You can actually go to Oakley and pick up bargains. It's not actually one that you'd read, but it's something to keep on the coffee book, and it's a nice little conversation piece. And the other thing is, for all us gays out there that only go as far as Commercial Road, Brunswick Street, anywhere, it will encourage us to seek bargains on the, what do they call, the ghettos of Melbourne. And there's also a mail order. I recommend this book to anyone out there that is fashion conscious, food conscious, or just wants to be absolutely ridiculous this year.
And I believe there's a homage to Ferrell Beryl from Frankster.
There most certainly is. There most certainly is. Now, we can actually get this signed by Ferrell Beryl and maybe auction it off later on down the track.
Oh, excellent.
I think so, but get out and get a copy of this. It's fabulous.
Oh, excellent.
And is it my turn again?
Yes, it is your turn.
Well, I'm just taking it.
About those gorgeous two women.
Well, here we go. I'll actually get you to hold that one. Be careful, because it's very windy up here on the roof, and there's no video in there. I left that at home. Now, we are all familiar with these two, and of course, everybody out there is wondering, are they, aren't they?
Well, I can tell you, they aren't.
Oh, no, I'm so disappointed. But anyway, the Two Fat Ladies rides again. The bid and the book are for release. Yeah, you can actually pick this up now. I recommend you go out and get a copy. But there are some fabulous, fabulous recipes in this one.
Well, my favourite was actually the Amish onion cake.
Was it really?
Yes.
Rubbing the two Boy Scouts together, was that Rowan?
Well, that was on the hot barn at night, but not sit like that.
Shh. Now, did you get a shot of that, Carol? That's one of the gorgeous dishes. And Go-Go's potted meat. Ooh. I mean, that is something that will drive any dinner guest crazy. And there's another one in here that I found very, very clever. Found a little recipe here, Rowan, which I'd really like your expert opinion on. Whether or not you're going to actually try this one out for your next dinner party. Mustard bloaters.
Well, I heard it was a real hit actually up in the Bent TV office, especially when they mentioned David Copperfield.
David Copperfield? Yes. What's that sort of thing?
Well, he was a favourite of mustard bloaters, apparently.
Was he really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, here's another one, red flannel hash.
Ooh.
Now, that's what I think that we'll all be getting into.
Too, yeah.
Anyway, grab out, go out, grab yourself a coffee, and you'll be entertained for the rest of your lives. Well, that's about it from Open Page this week. I'd like to say good evening.
And good evening.
Fantastic, and I think it's just so unique and it's so out there. I believe it's never coming back.
It's not coming back?
Well, no, I mean, this guy has just gone out and done something just so totally different and so totally controversial that I believe that there's nothing like controversy in art, is there?
Absolutely, look at Peace Christ. Controversy, art, what more can you ask for?
Not much more than that. Don't forget we're actually in front of St. Mark's.
That's right, Queer Zone. Christian style. and something you could ask for, not very controversial, but enjoyable, the gay and lesbian chorus.
Now, they are fantastic, aren't they, Nick?
I went down last Saturday night. We actually went down, Queers, I went down. It was a fabulous night at times. It was a religious experience. I got, you know, those tingles that go up your spine?
Oh, yes.
Push!
Yes, yes.
It's like that. It was a terrific night, and actually, we should go and have a look at it now. What do you reckon?
I think so.
Hi, we're here at the Melbourne Town Hall where the Melbourne Gay and Lesbian Chorus are performing Fabulous Voices tonight. Inside, they're all preparing at the moment and doing their dress rehearsal. So, let's take a wander inside and have a look. Kim, can you tell me what the Melbourne Gay and Lesbian Chorus is?
It's a group of lesbians and gay men who like to sing and camp it up a bit and get up there and have a go.
How did the Melbourne Gay and Lesbian Chorus come about?
Well, I'm not completely sure because I wasn't in the chorus from the inception, but I believe that a group or someone placed an ad in a community listing and a group of gay and lesbian people got together to sing. Initially they were known as All Sounds, and then a couple of years later, after I joined the choir, they changed the name to the Melbourne Gay and Lesbian Chorus.
And how long ago did this happen?
The change of name, approximately 2 years ago, Kim, something
maybe,
like that?
Maybe 3.
I think we changed the name, it was all voted upon, to become more of a gay and lesbian identity, I think.
And what sort of music do you perform?
Anything and everything. Everything from religious choruses to show tunes to anything you can think about. That's one of the advantages of the Gay and Lesbian Chorus, is that we perform anything and everything. We're very diverse.
Now, tonight you're performing in fabulous voices. How did the actual performance come about?
Well, Tuck Leong, who's our musical director, wanted to perform with other choirs, and so he basically approached a few other choirs and asked them whether they'd be interested. It's mainly a fundraising tonight for our trip to Amsterdam for the Gay Games in July and August, and so they've willingly offered their services, and it's all been organised since then.
Now, did the choir experience any forms of discrimination on the grounds that they were a gay and lesbian chorus when you approached other choruses to sing with?
This, I'm not aware of any discrimination whatsoever. We, the Melbourne Gay and Lesbian Chorus, actually rehearsed with Victoria Chorale late last year as merely a social occasion. And personally, that I know of, I don't know of any discrimination that I personally have experienced at all.
Most memorable performances?
My most memorable performance goes back a couple of years when the choir was entered in the Burundara Estedford, which is a mainstream choral Estedford, and we were in the open choral section and we won it. The choir was much smaller then, and it was just a high to go through the whole competitive process and then compete against two straight choirs, mainstream choirs, and we won. It was absolutely fantastic, and for me that's a memorable performance.
And you, Kim?
I think mine would have to be back here at Melbourne Town Hall. I think it's 2 years ago now, and we had the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Chorus and the choir and the Canberra choir. I can't remember their name. What are they called?
They're just called Choir with a Q.
Choir with a Q, that's right. And we had a combined concert. Everyone sang their own brackets, and then we all came together at the end, and we had about... I think we'd sold 1,700 tickets, and it was pretty awesome. I think it was the biggest audience I've ever sung to, and it was a full-on queer audience, and it was really good.
Sounds fabulous. Thank you, Tony and Kim, for your time, and I hope you enjoy your performance tonight and everything goes well for you. Okay, we're at the Piercing Urge, and we're with Peter today, and he's going to be doing a navel piercing for me. So, Peter, can you tell us exactly what you're going to be doing?
Right, the first thing I'm going to be doing, Troy, is cleaning your navel with some antiseptic. Then we're going to mark out where it's going to go and make sure everyone's happy with that. And once we've done that, we're going to lie down. put a small clamp on the area, then I'll do the piercing, insert the jewellery, close that up, and then clean it all up. It's as simple as that. One, two, three.
Okay, let's go for it.
Ticklish?
Yes.
Okay, this is just the clamp. This is just what's going to hold your skin in place. This is the little thing everyone's been waiting to see. Now it's that trick.
Ouch.
Wasn't that bad, was it?
No. It's over and done with before you know it.
Basically nipple jewellery. Some of this jewellery also doubles for genital piercings. And over here, the coloured niobium jewellery. This is also good for nipple piercings, navel piercings, and you could also wear these as well, genital piercings. And then there's my favourite board. It's all solid 18 karat gold, hence the hefty price tags, but very much worth. On this board here, you'll find mainly tongue jewellery, nipple jewellery, and this jewellery also doubles for genital piercings as well. Offers stone set tongue bars here, different colour balls, we're trying to have as much variety as we can. Then the next board over, you're looking at eyebrow jewellery, ear jewellery, lots of septum jewellery here. And then there's the labret jewellery here, which is the piercing that goes between the jewellery and the body. And then we have the ear spears, which are designed for people with normal sized ear holes that don't want to stretch them up but still want to have that big look.
Do you find a lot of the clientele coming off the street?
A lot of people, when they get the urge, they just have to come and do it now. So they come up and see us and hoping to be able to get it done straight away. If we're not busy, we'll certainly do that for them, but it is best to make an appointment if you want to have a piercing done.
I guess that's where you got the name from, the piercing urge.
Exactly, because it is very much an urge.
And do you get a lot of people through here?
We're doing between 150 and 200 piercings a week in Melbourne.
What's your most common form of piercing?
Navels, nipples, tongues, they're the most common at this time. They do just tend to change.
And how expensive is it to have a piercing done?
The piercings themselves start from $30 and go up to $50, and the jewellery generally starts between $35 and $55, although you can pay a lot more.
And whereabouts can people find the piercing urge?
The piercing urge in Melbourne is in Paran, and the piercing urge in Sydney is in Darlinghurst, and you can find either of us in the phone book.
Okay, Peter, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Troy. Hope you look after it.
I will.
What did you think of that, Mick?
Well, Troy was quite a man, wasn't he?
Absolutely. He's a brave and bold. I'm very proud of you
there,
Troy.
Good on you, Troy. No squealing?
No squealing at all.
I heard someone squeal, though.
Oh, that was probably somebody from the board in the background, probably, you know, pretending to be pierced or something like that. You know what they're like.
Are you pierced?
Oh, I was, Nick. I was pierced, but that's another story.
Whereabouts?
It was a nipple, yes. It was actually that one.
I went to bed once with a man who was pierced down below, and I had braces at the time.
time and it was a complete disaster, but I won't go into details now.
Please, could you?
No, I can't, because we have to go, because Girl Talk's coming up, that fabulous show with Kay Sara.
Fantastic. So stay tuned for Girl Talk and we'll see you again next week.
We'll zone your queer again, or something like that.
Proudly brought to you by the Also Foundation, developing the lesbian and gay community for over 15 years.